So today, first of all, I want to look at a distribution function, which is often called as probability distribution function, which determines the statistical behavior of large number of electrons. Okay, so the probability distribution function that determines the statistical behavior of a large number. Large means, if suppose you take 1 cm³ of a silicon crystal, then there are around 10^22 atoms inside that much volume, 1 cm³. And if each atom is donating 1 electron, then we will have around 10^22 electrons, right? So these numbers are very large. Okay, often the number of electron in the conduction band is of the order of, if it is an intrinsic material at room temperature, it is of the order of 10^10 per centimeter cube. But if you dope it with say n-type impurity, then the electrons in the conduction band goes to, depending upon the doping, it may go to 10^16, 10^17 per centimeter cube. So these are large number of electrons in the conduction band. So we need to find out mathematically how to determine this number, how to get what is the number of electrons in a conduction band, how many will occupy conduction band, or how many of them will be in the valence band. So this is determined by this statistical behavior. We are not interested exactly in where each electron are sitting. To that detail we don't require, but at least we need to know how many of them are in the conduction band, how many vacancies are there in the valence band. So these kind of statistical gross properties is that we are interested in, because they determines the conduction of the material, conductivity of the material. So probability distribution function that determines the statistical behavior of a large number of electrons is called as Fermi-Dirac distribution. Okay, there are other distributions also. One popular distribution is Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution, which is used in the kinetic theory of gas. So by using kinetic theory of gas, you can derive Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. There are some additional ingredients that we need to consider when you talk about the distribution of particles like electrons. For example, the two most important ingredients with respect to electrons in large number is that electrons obey Pauli's exclusion principle. Okay, Pauli's exclusion principle. They obey Pauli's exclusion principle. Another feature of electron is that there is no way we can distinguish between two electrons. You can't attach label to electron. To the big particles, say like balls, you can always label them. Like this is ball 1, ball 2, ball 3, or ABCD, or some name you can give. You can label them, but with respect to microscopic particles such as electron, there is no way you can distinguish one electron from the other. They all have identical property. So if you bring two electrons close to each other, then for example, one from the left side you brought and another from the right side you brought and put them together, the moment you put them together, you lose which one came from the left side or which one came from the right side. So they are indistinguishable. Electrons are indistinguishable. Particles. Indistinguishable. Okay. So these properties of electrons are taken into account. So if you have, suppose, some number of states available at a particular energy, then how many electrons, or and if you are putting say some n number of electrons into that level, okay, so there is at a particular energy we have some number of states available, and to those states if we are putting some n number of electrons, then how many ways you can put it. So that is basically a permutation combination calculation. So the Fermi Dirac distribution comes out of that combinatorial calculation, okay, permutation combination calculation. This distribution come out. So I'm not going to go through the derivation of it. Usually in this course on electronic devices, usually we don't go to the depth of deriving those distribution, but we will just use that distribution. First you will just write down that distribution, whatever is that distribution, and then we will try to understand what does it mean. Okay, but it comes from the combinatronics. That means how to fill the available states, satisfying Pauli's exclusion principle, satisfying indistinguishability of the particles, how to fill the states in a crystal. So we have seen bands, states are actually in the form of bands. So how to fill those states? So that is our consideration. We need to satisfy Pauli's exclusion principle. We need to satisfy the indistinguishability of the particles. So by carefully taking into consideration all those restrictions, we will, if you derive these statistics, that means basically if there are various energy levels, at each energy level, what is the probability of occupancy of those states. So, okay, how many electrons can be found in those states. So, this is basically the consideration in the derivation of this probability distribution function, which is called as Fermi-Dirac distribution. So, the distribution function can be written as F of E. Okay, it's a function of energy, and F of E is given as 1 by 1 plus e raised to e minus ef by kbt. So these are the parameters that appear. Of course, it is a function of energy. So what does it mean? It means that the probability of occupying state E is what this F of E is giving. So gives this distribution function gives the probability of occupying the energy state at E. Okay. So there is an energy at E, so if the electron, whether it will occupy or not, that is given by this distribution function. Now if you look at, there are some parameters, in addition to the variable E, we have some parameters. One is EF. And what is EF? EF is called Fermi energy level. EF is called Fermi energy level. And it is defined as, it is the energy at which occupation probability, it is the energy at which the occupation probability is half. That means there is a 50-50 chance for a level at EF is to be occupied. Okay. Then the other parameter is KBT. KB is Boltzmann constant. And value is 1.38 × 10⁻²⁷ joules per Kelvin. Okay. And then T is Kelvin, temperature in Kelvin. So these are the parameters. So KB into T, it is good to remember the value of KB into T at room temperature. So room temperature, what we mean is 300 degree Kelvin. This is a good thing to remember, 0.026 electron volt. Okay, in electron volt if you write. So usually we write energies in the atomic scale in electron volts, because that's a very small unit of energy compared to joules. Okay, you write it in joules because Boltzmann constant is very less. It is 1.38 × 10⁻², it becomes inconvenient. Okay, so now we understand everything that goes into the equation. We understand what is KB, T, EF, and then we can now plot it, this equation. Now depending upon the temperature that we consider, the plot is going to vary. So plot will vary with temperature, so and plot will vary with energy. So these are the two parameters that can vary. Okay, other things are constant here. So let's see at a particular temperature how the Fermi function looks like. So let's start with the temperature T equal to 0 degree Kelvin. Okay, that is absolute temperature. So plot of Fermi FD statistics, or statistical function at T equal to 0 degree Kelvin. So how does it look like? So we will take energy say in the vertical direction. Energy is going to be taken in the vertical direction, and the function is going to be plotted in the x direction. Okay, so this is convenient for in our course, because energy bands are always shown energy in the vertical direction, and that is the reason why we are doing this way. Okay, so now the probability can be anywhere from 0 to 1. That is the range, probability can take. Probability can never be greater than 1 or less than 0. So we need to take some value of for EF. EF is any energy level at which the probability of finding electron is half. Okay, so that is somewhere in between. So now I am going to plot it. So at T equal to 0 degree Kelvin, so let me draw. So this is how it will look like. Okay, probability till energy up to EF, it is going to be 1. That means all states complete surety that it will be occupied if it is less than EF. So that means what we are saying is f of E is equal to 1 if energy is less than EF. It is equal to 0 for E greater than EF. None of the states above the EF energy level will not be occupied. It will be completely vacant. Completely vacant. Whereas at energies less than EF, full occupancy. If whatever states is there below EF, they are completely occupied, and whatever states above EF, they are completely unoccupied. So let me write the expression once again. F of E is 1 by 1 plus E raised to E minus EF. I am taking T as 0, okay? So KB into 0. So that's how we are taking for this particular case, T equal to 0 degree Kelvin. So what will happen if this is 0 in the denominator of the exponent, then we are going to get a very huge number for any value other than EF, right? And that number is going to be either plus infinity or minus infinity. If E is greater than EF, then E is greater than EF means we have plus infinity. Okay, so this becomes 1 by 1 plus E raised to infinity for E greater than EF, and it will be equal to 1 by 1 plus E raised to minus infinity if E is less than EF. And if you look at E greater than EF, 1 by 1 plus E raised to infinity. E raised to infinity is huge, it is infinity. So this is basically equal to 0. And E raised to minus infinity is 0, so this is equal to 1. So this is how we get this. So that is how the function look like at this particular temperature. Okay, so T equal to 0 degree Kelvin. This is a temperature which is called as the absolute zero. Now, let's look at T greater than. So, FD statistical function for T greater than 0 degree. Now what will happen if temperature rises above 0 degree Kelvin? So again, I will take energy in the vertical direction and F of E, this is 1. The function can take only values between 0 and 1. And then we have a very important energy level which is called as EF, where we have, so there we know that it is equal to half. Half is somewhere here. So if I put, it has to pass through this. So let's draw it for different values of temperature. So at 0 degree Kelvin, we have something like a sudden transition. Now, if we slightly increase the temperature, what will happen is that we will have something like this. Okay, so this is the case when we have small temperature, okay, which is non-zero. So it is having some non-zero probability for energy just above EF. And if you further increase the temperature, so then show another temperature which is more hotter than the first temperature that we consider. Okay, so this way it changes. So I have drawn it for two different temperature. One I have drawn for T1, and then another one I have drawn for T2, and T2 is greater than T1. Okay, so T2 is a higher temperature. So again, let me just write this expression. F of E is 1 by, we need to just get familiar with this function, 1 plus e raised to e minus f by kBT. So this is our expression. Okay, so if e minus ef is positive, then we will have e raised to some positive quantity. Okay, and as e goes away from ef, positive quantity, that means this term is going to become much larger because it is coming in the exponent. So e raised to a positive quantity become very huge number as e is more shifted away from ef. Okay, so therefore the denominator of f of e becomes larger, means f of e becomes gradually go to zero. But when E is equal to EF, what happens? We have at E is equal to EF, what happens? We have F of EF, which is 1 by 1 plus E raised to EF minus EF, which is 0. So this is basically E raised to 0 is 1, so 1 by 1 plus 1, which is 1 by 2. So that is why I say that at that particular energy EF, we have probability equal to half. Any energy level beyond EF or greater than EF, we will have probability less than, because this term will be greater than 1, and therefore it will be 1 by 1 plus some other number which is greater than 1, and therefore we have reducing probability as we go to higher and higher energy values. Now similarly, if you look at any energy value below EF, then E minus EF become negative, and E raised to some negative quantity is a quantity lesser than 1. Okay, it is a quantity lesser than 1, so it will be 1 by 1 plus a quantity lesser than 1, so we will get F of E as something larger than half. Okay, it will be 1 by 1 plus say 0.5. So that will be 1 by 1.5 is 2 by 3. F of E will become 2 by 3. So like that you can see what happens as you increase. So as you increase E above EF, your function reduces and goes to 0. And as you go down from EF, then what happens? The function goes to F of E becomes 1 as you go down. Okay, so there is a range of values where it varies between 1 and 0. So we can see that in this particular case, from here to somewhere here. So there is a range of energy where it varies between from 1 to 0. And that range where it varies basically increases with increase in temperature. For the first case, you can see that it varies only say from here to here, only for a small range. Okay, so this is of the order of KVT. So as temperature increases, your KBT will also increase. This is KBT2, and this one is KBT1, of the order of, okay, this is not exactly I am saying, but of the order of the width where the variation of F of E happens is of the order of KBT. So it may be few kVTs also, but it is determined by the value of kVT. So as temperature increases, it becomes more and more flat like this. Okay. So that is our Fermi Dirac distribution function, which determines which determines the probability of occupying a particular electron energy state. Okay, so now if you compare this with our band diagram, so now let's go to the band structure of say some particular atom. I'm not now specifying which atom it is, but we have to take a particular atom. For a particular crystal, and for that crystal we need to take energy band structure. So let's draw so density of states of a particular atom and the Fermi Dirac distribution function together. So energy band structure and the occupancy of electron states. So we are interested in knowing the occupancy of electron states given the energy band structure. So first thing is we have derived the density of states earlier. So let me draw that first of all. So energy is in vertical direction. Let's say this is our EC. We got something like this for a 3D material. Remember this expression. This expression we obtained as check it. What was the expression that we derived for so we got the density of states d of e as 4 pi into 2 m star, which is the effective mass of the electron in the conduction band. So that I will denote with a suffix n, or you can also use e, electron effective mass. Then this divided by h cube into e minus ec. So this is the density of states that we derived for conduction band. And similarly, we had for valence band. So let's say this is our EV, and then something like this. So these are like function is of the form like square root of E. That is why we get something like a parabola. So here it will be same form, only thing is that here it is the effective mass of electron in the valence band, and the effective mass of electron in the valence band, top of the valence band, it is basically negative, but we take the absolute value of that as the effective mass of holes divided by h cube. So this we have derived earlier, V minus E. Okay, so if you are not remembering, you go back to the earlier results or earlier classes where we have derived this expression. So this is what is called as the density of states. Okay, so this is density of state. Now, in order to distinguish between the two, let's say this is conduction band and this is say density of states for the valence band. So these are basically the way states or the density of the states are varying with respect to E, which means what? So let me try to interpret. Between EC and EV, there is no place for electron to sit. Okay, it's completely forbidden. So in this range of energy, we don't have any states available. That means, as if in a class, we don't have any chairs put in for some distance. Okay, so nobody can sit there. Okay, but somewhere at the front, you have chair put. Maybe here one chair put, then you have two chair put, three chair put, four chair put, five chair put. So it's a arrangement of states. The arrangement of states means the place where electron can sit. Similarly, when you go to higher energy, there also you can see that as you go in increasing direction of energy, then you have more states available for at a particular energy level for electron to sit. Now, so this is the calculation that we get out of quantum mechanical considerations. Okay, we solve the Schrodinger equation and we have got this density of state functions. Okay, from the band structure. So next thing is how are these states going to be occupied? Now, if you look at how these states going to be occupied, that is entirely a different thing that is determined by the Fermi-Dirac distribution. Okay, so whether any of these states in the conduction band, so this is basically called conduction band, and this is basically called the valence band. Will the conduction band be occupied, or only valence band will be occupied? So these are the questions that is determined by Fermi-Dirac distribution. So if you consider the Fermi-Dirac distribution on the top of this density of states, so that will decide the occupancy of these states. Okay, so by combining the two, Fermi-Dirac distribution and the density of states, we can find out the number of electrons in the conduction band and number of electrons in the valence band. So let me also draw the Fermi-Dirac distribution. So let me take say EF somewhere here. This is my EF somewhere at the okay. So let me just. So this is my EF somewhere between EC and EV. And then I'm going to draw on the top of this another curve. So what I have already drawn is density of states, d of e, dc of e, and dv of e. This is what I have already drawn. Now on the top of this, I am also going to draw another quantity, which is f of e. And this is f of e equal to 1, and this is f of e equal to 0. And if this is your EF, then it has to be half somewhere here. So it has to be half between 0 and 1. And then it varies from 1, it varies to 0. So, but it has to pass through. It has to pass through this half point. Okay. So this is the variation we have seen earlier, just above. Okay. So Fermi-Dirac function will vary like this. Maybe it doesn't look very good, but maybe I will draw so that it will be more clear. So till here approximately it is 1. So somewhere till somewhere here, this is the 1 and this is the 0. So this is 1 and this is 0, and it goes from 0 to 1 through this point, which is half. This is the half point, and that is at EF. That is what we call as EF. Now if you look at there is some finite probability, so which is decreasing, that you know some of the states can be occupied. So this is a probability distribution function which is going to 0, and similarly there is a finite probability that it is going to be empty in the valence band also. So I hope you can see what I'm trying to say. So it is not exactly equal to 1 at the top of the valence band, okay. It is little less than 1, okay. So this is 1 and it is little less than 1 here at the top of the valence band. Similarly, if you look at the bottom of the conduction band, EC, there it is not exactly 0, it is little above 0. So what does that mean? It means that these reddish portions which I have shown here, highlighted here, there is a non-zero probability of occupying the states available there. In between EV and EC there is no state available, so there is no question of occupancy there. Although the probability of occupancy is somewhere between 0 and 1, but since states are not available, you know, even if the probability is 1, there is no way it can be occupied. Because for occupancy you should have some states available there, then only you can put electron in it. If chairs are not there, nobody can sit there. Okay, so in that way, if states are not there, electron cannot be put in there. Okay, even if the probability of occupying those energy states are finite, but there are no states available, so it cannot. But states are available only in the conduction band and in the valence band, and the density or how the number of states varies with respect to energy, that is what density of state function shows. Okay, so these two things are put in one upon the and I have taken a EF which is somewhere in between EC and EF, okay, and that is usually the case in semiconductors. That is why I have taken like that. Our EF is a level somewhere between EC and EV. For intrinsic, it is almost at the middle. Okay, so let's assume that we are considering intrinsic semiconductor where there is no doping involved. So EF is somewhere at the middle, not exactly at the middle. We will see a little later that it is not exactly at the middle, but so at a given temperature you have this function, you know, spread out into the conduction band and into the valence band. Okay, if the temperature was really zero, then what will happen is that if it is 0 degree Kelvin, then we know that Fermi Dirac function will look like this, green. In that case, everything below the everything below the EF is occupied, everything above it is unoccupied, and which means that no electrons in the conduction band, and the valence band is completely full. So that we can write here. So if T is equal to 0 degree Kelvin, then for, so this is intrinsic semiconductor we are taking, intrinsic semiconductor, the valence band is completely filled and conduction band, I'll write CB for conduction band, is completely empty. Okay, so that is at 0 degree temperature. But then at a greater temperature, say like room temperature, but at T equal to say 300 degree Kelvin, there exist non-zero probability for conduction band states to be occupied, and correspondingly the valence band to be emptied out. Okay, so you see this area, that is, there is some non-zero probability, or there is some probability that vacancy to be created in the valence band. Why? Because the probability is not 1. So you can't say that valence band will be completely occupied. It is a 0.9, for example, at the top of the valence band. That means only 90% of states will be occupied. 10% will be vacant. So when you look at the conduction band, there is 10% of chance for that to get occupied, because your Fermi Dirac function is something like 0.1 here. Okay, so this one, I'm saying this is around 0.1. Whereas here, it is 0.9. So this is the occupancy. So one is 0.1, other is 0.9. Okay. So 0.1 means there is it is not completely empty. There is some electron. 10% of states are occupied. 0.9 means it is not completely filled. There is some vacancy because only 90% is occupied. So we can look at it in another way. As the temperature is increased, more and more electrons will find energy to go from the valence band to the conduction band. So making some of the valence band states to become empty and some of the conduction band to become occupied. Okay, but if the temperature is small, then you won't find any electron able to cross the barrier, that is forbidden barrier, which is EG. You will not find any electron to cross this barrier. So this is our EG. So this barrier has to be overcome, then only it can go from conduction band to valence band. So how can the electron in the intrinsic semiconductor cross this barrier? By acquiring the energy from the thermal excitation. Okay, so only when thermal excitation happens, that is, so for that you need to have some amount of temperature. At room temperature you will get many electrons getting that enough energy to cross the barrier to go from valence band to conduction band, and that makes the occupation of conduction band and vacancy in the valence band. So we are now going to calculate the number of electrons, okay, number densities. So density of, if you know the density of states and the probability function, then we can talk about what is called as the number density. Okay. So calculation of number density of electrons in conduction band and number density of holes in valence band. So how can we calculate how many electrons are there in the conduction band, and how many holes are there in the valence band. So what we need to do? So we have the density of states, which is dc of E. That gives the number of states, density of states in the conduction band as a function of energy, and then we have f of E. So that when you multiply, you get basically what is called as the n of E. N of E is basically the number density of electrons. Okay, so this is n of E. Similarly, you can have P of E, that is holes are denoted by E. So that is density of states in the valence band multiplying with the probability that it will get vacant. So that will be 1 minus F of E. Okay. F of E is the probability that probability of occupying the states. Okay, so let me just F of E is the probability to occupy state E or state at E. State at E. Whereas 1 minus F of E is the probability to probability for the state at E to be vacant. So vacancy is what we call as holes. So if you want to find out the number of holes, we need the probability that that state is unoccupied. Okay, probability that state is unoccupied is 1 minus F of E. F of E is the probability that the state is occupied. So when you do 1 minus F of E, we get basically, so if F of E is 0.9, 1 minus F of E, that is 0.1, is the probability that valence band will be unoccupied, which is what give rise to holes. So this is what we need to get. So that is the number density of electrons and number density of holes. So this is P of E. So if you have the number density of electrons and holes, then we can find out the total number of electrons in the therefore the total number of electrons in the conduction band is going to be equal to let's call it as n0. It is going to be n of E dE. Okay, number density, if you integrate over the entire conduction band. So the conduction band from starting, which is basically EC, to the end. Okay, end of the conduction band. If you integrate, that will give you the total number of electrons in the conduction band. Similarly, the total number of holes in the valence band. So that is P0. Now how do we integrate this? So this we need to integrate downward. So from EV to the bottom. So for conduction band we need to integrate till the top of the conduction band. So here bottom of valence band you have to integrate. EV is called the top of the valence band, and we don't know what is the bottom of the valence band. It depends. Okay. Similarly, EC is called the bottom of the conduction band. We don't know how far it goes up. Okay. How much is the spread of the conduction band? So whatever is the spread of the conduction band, so till that point we need to integrate it. Okay. So this will be P of E dE. So let's evaluate this. So N0 is basically integral EC to top of conduction band, and let us substitute for N of E. Now phi is basically product of density of states and f of e. So dc of e, okay, conduction band density of states into f of e dE. So let's try to evaluate this by substituting. So let's substitute. What is the expression for so this is equal to integral EC to the top of conduction band. Since I don't know the energy corresponding to the top of conduction band, I'm just writing it like this. So DC of E is what? DC of E is basically 4 pi into 2 me star electron effective mass raised to 3 by 2 by h cube and into e minus ec square root. Okay, so you can either write like this or you can write in bracket and then write whole raised to 1 by 2 into, now f of e we know it is basically 1 by 1 plus e raised to e minus ef by kbt, and this I have to integrate over order. Now again let's go back to the plot of these functions. So the first part is basically d of e, so this is our conduction band density of states d of e, and this is my f of e, and we have plotted both on the same graph earlier. So let us go there and look at what happens. You see that the f of e, which I have plotted in this orange color, it goes to zero. It goes to zero, exponentially it goes to zero as e increases, it goes to zero. So since it goes to zero very quickly, it doesn't matter whether you integrate the whole thing up to infinity or to the top of the conduction band. Okay, so let me assume that suppose our top of the conduction band is somewhere here like this. So this is the top of conduction band here somewhere. So whether we integrate from here or if I continue to integrate beyond this, assuming that it goes like this, it doesn't make any difference. Why? Because this function is zero. This function is perfectly going to zero. It is zero here, and therefore, whether I integrate the product of these two, that is, this function and this exponentially decaying function, this is e raised to minus half, and this is e raised to minus e. Okay, so more dominating function is exponential decay compared to the rise of the polynomial e raised to half. So when you take the product, the exponential will dominate and it will make the product to go to zero. So another way of looking at it is to draw n of e function. So the product is called as n of e. Okay, so this together we call it as n of e. So if you look at the plot of n of e, how it will look like. So let me just draw this again, and then so first of all I have energy, so it goes increasing like this, and then I have another function which is exponentially decaying like this. Okay, okay, like this. So that is where we have EF. So when you multiply these two, that is the orange into this purple, then the function that I am going to get, if I show here, the only place where, so d of e is 0 here, so it will be 0. Till this point, everything will be 0. So this is our EC, and then it will increase. And then it will go to 0. So this is our so we are basically finding the area this way. Now the second thing I told you is that suppose this function like stops here at some particular point. So this is that, then we call it as the top of conduction band. Okay, conduction band is only from this point to this point. So we only need to integrate from here to here. But it doesn't make a difference if you integrate till infinity, because anyhow this function goes to 0. So if you integrate till infinity, or if I integrate till this top of this conduction band, it doesn't make any difference, because all that you have from the contribution of the product function n of e. So this product function is n of e. This is E, and here E. So this is your N of E. And similarly, I can say this one is your D of E, and this one is your F of E. This is one. Okay, so the n of e plot looks like this, and we need to just integrate the area and find out the area of n of e with respect to energy from EC to infinity. So that will give you the number of particles. So instead of stopping this integration at the top of the conduction band, we would write it as integral from EC. So let me take the constants outside the integral. So I have 4 pi into 2 me star raised to 3 by 2, then by h cube, then integral from EC to infinity. Okay, I changed it from top of the conduction band. Instead of stopping here, I am saying it is up to infinity, assuming that my d of e continues like this, and my f of e is 0, like this. So effectively it becomes 0. So even if you continue the integration beyond the top of the conduction band, the result will not change. Then we have E minus EC all raised to half into 1 by 1 plus E raised to E minus EF by KET. So this is the integration we need to perform. Okay, so let's take a break.